Hey there, AP Environmental Science class. All right, so we're moving on now to Chapter 9, Sustaining Biodiversity, Saving Species and Ecosystem Services. So once again, I'll break this lecture up into two parts. There are about 52 slides or so. So sit back and get ready to enjoy, or at least to learn, something on sustaining biodiversity. All right, so core case study. They start off the chapter talking about where have all the honeybees gone. A little interesting fact, I took a course at Cornell called Introductory Beekeeping when I was a senior in college. It was one of the greatest classes I've ever taken. We actually every day, or I think it was every other day we met, we actually went out to the beehives. Cornell has a whole beehive research area, and we went out there and we basically played with bees. It was pretty cool, and it's something I'm hoping to get into as a hobby myself one of these days when I get around to it. I'm going to buy some beekeeping equipment and kind of put it right in my backyard here, some honeybees. So we'll see. I haven't done it yet, but I'm hoping to do it. Maybe I've been thinking about buying it this winter. I'll see if I get my act together. So bees play a key role in pollination. One of the reasons I want to get my own beehive back here is because I actually am an at-home gardener. I do a lot of gardening myself, and so I'm thinking that with extra bees around, that I might actually get more fruit, more yield, because bees do play a key role in pollination. So I'll let you know how that goes if I actually decide to do it. European honeybees pollinate over 70% of vegetable and fruit crops. Commercial beekeepers truck hives to farms to actually pollinate different crops, believe it or not. But right now we're having something called a colony collapse disorder. Basically, when bees abandon a colony, this is affecting up to 43% of European honeybees in the U.S. between 2008 and 2015. So it is an issue. Researchers don't know exactly why this is happening, this colony collapse disorder. But basically, the bees just choose to abandon a colony, and then that's pretty much it. So unfortunately, things like that are going on right now. And this is why we need to figure out ways to sustain our biodiversity and our ecological services. Obviously, honeybees are an ecological service, right? The pollination of crops, very important for us. And that's something that honeybees do for us. And here is a picture of these little guys. What I loved about the class, Introduction to Honeybees, is how docile these are. I actually would have these bees land on my hand and I would pet them. So believe it or not, honeybees are very docile. If you notice these out in nature, don't get worried. It's wasps. It's those yellow jackets. Those are the ones that get you. Honeybees, unless you disturb them or step on their hive, they're really rather docile and rather calm creatures. So again, I found that very interesting. So what role do humans play in the loss of species and ecosystem services? Well, unfortunately, we're playing a huge role right now. Species are currently becoming extinct at least 1,000 times faster than the historical rate. So think about that right now. We are seeing species become extinct 1,000 times faster than normal. By the end of this century, extinction rates are expected to be 10,000 times higher than they should be. So what are we talking about? Well, a biological extinction occurs when a species can no longer be found anywhere on Earth. So when we talk about extinction, we're talking about biological extinction. And again, that means we can't find that creature anywhere else on the planet. Once it's totally gone, we say that species is extinct. So extinctions are natural, but sometimes they increase sharply. So extinction is a natural process. It's known as the background extinction rate. So the background extinction measures the natural rate of extinction, and that usually is one extinct species per year per 1 million species, okay? So that is our normal background extinction rate that happens every day for the course of history, okay? One extinct species per year per million of species. However, mass extinctions have occurred 5 previous times in our history, and we're saying right now we may be currently in the 6th mass extinction. So extinctions of many species in a short period of time is called a mass extinction. Past causes most likely involve global changes in environmental conditions. So for instance, let me show you, I'm going to stop this and I'm going to go to a chart. All right, here are the 6, or at least the 5 previous mass extinctions. So one occurred about 445 million years ago at the end of the Ordovician period. 60 to 70% of creatures on Earth became extinct. Then we had one during the Devonian period. At the end of that period, about 370 or so million years ago, we had drastic drops in oxygen levels, which caused 75% of Earth's creatures to become extinct. Then the end of the Permian, looks like some asteroid impacts and intense volcanic activity 252 million years ago, 95% of Earth's creatures, of Earth's species, became extinct during at the end of the Permian period. This almost was it, guys, because if you go 100%, life has to start all over again. So luckily, we didn't go 100%. We had 5% of life remaining intact at the end of the Permian, and that's lucky for us, or I would argue that we probably wouldn't be here as a human species. End of the Triassic, in debate right now, massive volcanic eruptions, maybe asteroids, but 70 to 80% of Earth species became extinct. Then we had at the end of the Cretaceous period, that's that KT boundary. This is when the dinosaurs became extinct. Okay, an asteroid impact. 75% of creatures became extinct during this time. And now we are probably in the sixth one, known as the Anthropocene extinction. And why is it called the Anthropocene? Well, because that's humans, okay? That's a human-made extinction. And right now we are probably in the sixth mass extinction. And what is causing it? Homo sapiens, you and I, or at least a human species, is causing the most current one that we are in right now. All right, so back to the slides here. All right, mass extinctions can be an opportunity for species to fill empty ecological niches. So that's what we feel happened at the end of the Cretaceous period. All the dinosaurs died, but that allowed little mammals to be able to take over the Earth. And it's these little mammals that are our descendants. So if it wasn't for that Cretaceous extinction, that fifth one with the dinosaurs, we might not be here as human beings either, right? Because that mass extinction of those big reptiles allowed smaller animals, smaller mammals, to be able to get a stronger foothold. And then they were the ones who obviously ended up dominating the planet since the dinosaurs became extinct. Human population, though, has destroyed and degraded habitats. Huge resource consumption and large ecological footprint. Again, things we've been talking about since the beginning of this course. And again, those extinction rates have risen recently. Current extinction rate, 1,000 times higher than that natural background rate we talked about. And that's why we think we're in this sixth mass extinction right now. Again, we call it the Anthropocene extinction because, again, Anthropocene, human-made, human-induced, okay? And we feel that that's the extinction that we are in right now. Rate of extinction and threats to ecosystem services likely to rise sharply in the next 50 to 100 years. Again, due to our harmful human impacts. Once again, we said now 1,000 times faster than the natural background rate of extinction. A large-scale loss of species would greatly impact ecosystem services that humans rely on. Biologically diverse environments are being eliminated or fragmented. So again, all of this is decreasing our biodiversity because we're basically seeing creatures, species become extinct at an alarming rate. So Science Focus 9.1 talks about estimating those extinction rates. All right, problems. So we do have some problems estimating the rates because natural extinction of species is a long process, so it's difficult to document. We've actually only identified 2 million of the 7 to 10 million species on Earth, and we actually know little about the ecological roles of most identified species. So again, this is why environmental science is such a budding science, and why I know many of you are actually considering going into this field in college, there's a lot still to be learned. So this really is an open field with a lot of information still need to be gathered. So again, there's definitely room for you guys if this is where you want to head. The approach, we need to observe how reductions in habitat area affect extinction rate. So a couple of terms to talk about: endangered and threatened species are our ecological smoke alarms, as the book says. So what's an endangered species? An endangered species has so few individuals left that the species could very soon become extinct. A threatened species, also called a vulnerable species, still enough individuals to survive, but the numbers are declining and may soon become an endangered species. So a threatened or a vulnerable species, not as dire as an endangered species, but unfortunately it's heading in that direction. Many species have characteristics that make them vulnerable to extinction. And we actually talked a little bit about those about those characteristics in previous units. We'll talk about it again in just a second. But here are some just examples of some creatures that are endangered, critically endangered. You'll notice the Mexican gray wolf. We only got about 42 left in the world. Okay, California condor, 225 left, but up from only 9 in 1986, so getting a little better. Whooping crane, only over 400 left, and you'll notice the Sumatran tiger, maybe 600 left on the Indonesian islands of Sumatra. That's about it, okay? So these creatures are critically endangered. Here again are some characteristics that make creatures more, or make species more prone to become extinct. And we talked about some of these, right? The low reproductive rate, that K-strategist, right? Like whales, giant pandas, okay? Even like humans, for instance. Specialized niches like the panda, right? They only can live in a certain area, all right? Narrow distribution. So remember, that's that kind of tolerance range, right? Certain species can only live with really certain characteristics, okay? Feeds at high trophic levels. So that's a characteristic you become extinct, because if anything messes up at the bottom of a food chain, well, the guys at the top are gonna deal with that first, all right? Creatures with fixed migratory patterns, as we begin to fragment, we'll talk about that in a little bit. Fragmenting means if you had, let's say, a forest here, and now you cut a road through it, now the forests are fragmented. Individuals that would normally migrate through the forest can't get to that other forest because there's a barrier now in between. So that is an issue. If they have fixed migratory patterns, well, then obviously now there's going to be some problems when you get this fragmentation of their habitats. Obviously rare, right? If you're rare to begin with, could be endangered. Commercially valuable, okay? Like for instance, elephants and rhinoceroses, okay? Some people want their tusks, want their skin, okay? So if they're commercially valuable, could have problems. And of course, require large territories, right? Because with our territories getting fragmented or even getting smaller, these habitats, obviously, if you're a creature or species that needs a large territory, well, then you could be prone to extinction faster than other species. So why should we try to sustain wild species and the ecosystem services they provide? Well, the reasons to avoid hastening the extinction of wild species are many. They provide valuable ecosystem and economic services, right? It can take millions of years for nature to recover from large-scale extinctions. And many people believe that species have a right to exist regardless of their usefulness to humans, okay? So these are all reasons that we need to avoid the hastening of creatures becoming extinct. So an example is the orangutan. Are only about 61,000 remain in the wild. Their tropical forest habitat being cleared to grow palm oil. They are illegally smuggled and sold because they're commercially viable. They have the lowest birth rate of all animals, so obviously puts them square in that issue for becoming endangered, and they may disappear within 2 decades without urgent protective action. Here is what an orangutan looks like. And again, these are creatures that are endangered, okay? And because their characteristics, unfortunately, their traits lead them to be more vulnerable to extinction. And so these are creatures that we really have to make sure that we look out for. Again, species provide vital ecosystem services like pollination, when we talked about bees, like pest control, like some beetles, oxygen production, like plants, right? Many plants and animals provide economic value, medicinal drugs. Extinction can hinder speciation. So that's the other issue. When you become extinct, the less creatures you have, the less biodiversity, the less new species can be created, right? So not only does extinction wipe out creatures that are here, but it also prohibits new species from being created. It hinders speciation. Many people believe species have an intrinsic right to exist. Why shouldn't they, right? And of course, the big question is, which species should we protect? So again, here are just some plants that are vital to Earth's natural capital. You'll notice some of these plants here. I'm not going to try to butcher some of these names, but for instance, the foxglove, I can get that one, actually helps with some heart failure, or the Pacific yew is an ovarian cancer, used in ovarian cancer drugs, okay? The rosy periwinkle is used to help in Hodgkin's disease leukemia, some types of leukemia. So again, these plants are important, and if they become extinct, well, then we lose those plants and we lose their natural capital. Again, here's a parrot. Why do we have this? Because it's beautiful, right? They're beautiful birds. That's part of Earth's natural capital as well, aesthetics. Well, unfortunately, they become extinct. We lose that and we lose those beautiful aesthetics. All right, so how do humans accelerate species extinction and degradation of ecosystem services? The greatest threat to species, there's this acronym, HIPCO. You need to memorize this, okay? The H stands for habitat loss, degradation, or fragmentation. The I stands for invasive species. The first P stands for population and resource use growth. The second P, pollution. The C, climate change. And the O, over-exploitation or over-harvesting. All right, so in order to memorize these, memorize that acronym HIPCO, okay? Habitat loss, invasive species, too much population, pollution, climate change, and over-exploitation, okay? So those are your six greatest threats to species here on Earth because of humans, okay? We're doing these six, all right? And these are our greatest threat to species. So definitely put these six to memory. So habitat fragmentation occurs when large intact habitats divide into smaller isolated patches, like I was describing before. So this is caused by roads, logging, crops, and urban development. Barriers limit species' ability to disperse and colonize area, locate food and mates, etc. So again, think of it as barriers. You have this great big forest. All of a sudden now you cut a road through the middle of the forest, okay? Some creatures may not be able to get across that road. So now you've taken this huge habitat and you fragmented it into two habitats. Well, that's going to potentially lead to issues, right? Because if species can't get to their other parts of their habitat, they could potentially become extinct. Think about then if you take those two habitats and you cut another road through each of them, now you have one cut into four. So again, as we do this as humans, as we build roads, as we build homes, as we clear tropical rainforests and put in agriculture, okay, we are fragmenting and dividing these habitats into smaller isolated patches, which eventually some creatures can't adapt quick enough, and therefore they become extinct. And that's what we're seeing happening right now. So for instance, you'll notice the Indian tiger, black rhino, African elephant, the Asian or Indian elephant. Again, here are their ranges 100 years ago is in the purple. Look at their ranges today in the pink. Again, look at the black rhino. It was widespread. Now it's only left in a couple of areas. Same thing for the African elephant. Pretty much everywhere Southern Africa had this African elephant roaming around. Now, only these areas that are in red, okay? So their habitat is getting fragmented. They're not able to move around as much. And this, unfortunately, is part of the reason that these animals are becoming or are endangered and are becoming extinct because of this habitat destruction and fragmentation. And again, this is just another picture. This is what I've been explaining. Remember, see these forested areas here? This entire picture was forest at one point. And now, little bit of forest left, but there's homes, right? There's fields for people to plant crops. Here's some habitat, but then it's dispersed. So again, if you live up here, okay, if you're a creature that lives in this habitat, you can't get down here anymore, right? Because you would have to, your habitat has been fragmented and destroyed, all right? And this is a big issue around the world, and this is a big issue that is leading to a decline in biodiversity because species are becoming extinct. They're not able to adapt to these fragmenting habitats as quickly as we as humans are fragmenting their habitats. Other issues that humans have done is the I, invasive species. Many species introductions are beneficial, but many are not. Non-native species may have no natural predators, competitors, parasites, or pathogens, and so they basically grow unchecked. Non-native species can crowd out native species. They're viewed as harmful, and so we call them invasive species. So these are species that are not common to an area. They're either most likely brought in by humans, okay, some kind of human trafficking, maybe on a plane, maybe on a boat, okay, maybe just from your car from one area of the country to another, okay, you bring in something that is not native, an invasive species, and it could run unchecked in an environment because it doesn't have any natural predators or competitors or anything like that because it's not normally in that environment, okay, us humans have brought it in. So here are just some invasive species. The tops were deliberately introduced by humans, okay, and didn't work out well, all right? The purple loosestrife, the African honeybee, known as the killer bees, the kutso vine, nutria, kind of a little rodent here, or the European wild boar, accidentally introduced species, the sea lamprey, the Argentine fire ant, all right, the Burmese python, this type of termite, the zebra mussel, okay, the zebra mussel is an interesting story. It was actually brought into the Great Lakes via boats, all right? Boats basically have water in them to kind of balance them out. Well, these boats were coming from Europe and actually had these zebra mussels in these tanks in the boat. Well, when the boats get to where they're getting to, they actually expel out all the water in their tanks. And so these boats expelled out all this water into the Great Lakes. These zebra mussels were not native, ended up being expelled out through these boats. And now we have an issue with these zebra mussels clogging a lot of the Great Lakes and destroying other native species in the Great Lakes because they were accidentally introduced. But since they don't have any natural predators, they're not natural, they're basically able to run unchecked. So the case study in the book talks about the kutso vine and the kutso bugs imported from Japan in the 1930s to help control soil erosion. But unfortunately, this vine spreads so rapidly that it's taking over land. It's very difficult to kill. All right, a common fungus can kill the kutso vine, but we need to investigate its harmful side effects. There are potential benefits of this vine, medical and nutritional uses, maybe potential use as a paper or biofuel. But right now, this vine is running amok everywhere. Here we go. I mean, this is incredible, right? This is a picture of the kutso vine here, this guy's car, all right? And these vines just take over. So they were brought in deliberately to help with soil erosion, but unfortunately, because they're not native, they're considered an invasive species. They are unfortunately running amok in many areas where they were initially brought on in. So some accidentally introduced species can disrupt ecosystems. Again, we kind of talked about it, but this is the notes: Burmese python, the African python, boa constrictor in Florida. They were pets imported from Africa and Asia and released into the Everglades wetlands. Predation by these animals is altering food webs and ecosystem services in the wetlands or in the Everglades because why? They're not native. So now you have this nice food web. You throw in some other animals, and in this case, predators. And now it's disrupting the entire food web, disrupting the ecosystem services of the Everglades, and that could potentially lead to extinctions and to a reduction in biodiversity down the road. And again, here's just a picture of one of those boa constrictors found in Florida. Again, brought in as pets on purpose, then released because people didn't want them. They realized, how the heck can I have that in my house? Okay, so they release it into the wild, and now you got these things that aren't supposed to be in the Everglades, roaming around the Everglades and running amok with the ecosystem services and the biodiversity there in the Everglades. Okay, so that's going to be the end of part one. We will come back and start off with controlling invasive species in part two. So I will see you guys then.